This joint hearing of the Subcommittee on Research and Technology and the Subcommittee on Oversight will come to order. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to today's hearing titled Technology Needed to Secure America's Border. In front of you are packets containing the written testimony, biography, and truth and testimony disclosures for today's witnesses. Before we get started, since this is a joint hearing involving two subcommittees, I want to explain how we operate procedurally so that all members understand how the question and answer period will be handled. We will recognize those members present at the gavel in order of seniority on the full committee, and those coming in after the gavel will be recognized in order of arrival. I recognize myself now for 5 minutes for an opening statement. 12 years ago, the Homeland Security Act established the Directorate for Science and Technology within the Department of Homeland Security. The S&T Directorate manages and carries out science and technology research for our federal homeland security needs. The Directorate is also responsible for coordinating this research with other federal research entities. The Committee on Science, Space, and Technology shares oversight of the S&T Directorate with the Homeland Security Committee. Since this spring, this subcommittee has been planning a joint hearing with our counterparts in the Homeland Security Committee to hear from the Department of Homeland Security S&T Directorate. So this has been a long planned hearing. It's just today is the day that it would work out for us to do this. Unfortunately, Department of Homeland Security could not work that into their schedule. But there will be another hearing in September that will complete this hearing. Unfortunately, we could not make the calendars come together, like I said, and I'm looking forward to the Department of Homeland Security testifying in September. The DHS S&T Directorate is responsible for developing new technologies from basic research to development for use, including technologies that can help to secure our nation's border. From unmanned aerial vehicles to tunnel detection, from anti-counterfeit standards to biometrics, there are existing and promising new technologies that can act as force multipliers for Border Patrol agents and the Coast Guard to augment their day-to-day work on border security-related issues. We will hear this morning from the Government Accountability Office, which has issued a series of reports about DHS technology research and development, and from two private sector experts, each of whom can contribute on a different aspect of border security technology. I look forward to hearing from all of our witnesses. I now recognize the ranking member, gentleman from Illinois, Mr. Lipinski, for an opening statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for calling this hearing today, and thank our witnesses for providing valuable testimony on this issue. Today we'll hear about how the Department of Homeland Security can improve its research and development efforts on technology to secure America's borders. With growing turmoil around the world, the threats we face at our borders are more pressing than ever. These threats include terrorists and criminals entering our country, human trafficking, drug trafficking, and other dangerous materials and substances being smuggled into the U.S. As has been said many times, those wishing America harm only need to get it right once. To keep America safe, we need to get it right every time. This daunting task falls largely on the shoulders of DHS. As a member of both the Science, Space, and Technology Committee and the Transportation Infrastructure Committee, I'm especially concerned with border security as it relates to transportation. Last week, I met with Commissioner of U.S. Customs and Border Protection, Gil Kurokowski, on their efforts to develop technology such as fingerprint scanners at O'Hare Airport in Chicago as part of CBP's Global Entry Program. Science and technology plays a critical role in addressing our homeland security challenge. However, the department has been plagued with problems in its planning and management of research and development. The agency is young, having been only created 11 years ago. While I do not envy the task of stitching together several government programs and functions into a new agency, I remain concerned that several of the problems we saw in the agency's initial years remain today. As GAO has previously stated, the department cannot tell us how much they invest in R&D. There is a lack of effective communication between operational components and the Science and Technology Directorate. Furthermore, there is still no strategic plan in place to guide the department's research and development activities. It is important to understand the steps the agency goes through in identifying and solving a technological problem, whether for border security or another mission need. When agents in the field identify a technological challenge, how is this need passed along to the researchers developing the technology? The communication between the operational components of DHS and the researchers at the Science and Technology Directorate has to be improved. Once the technology is developed, it must be thoroughly tested and evaluated to see that it not only functions as intended, but is adapted for the environment in which it will operate. Understanding how CBP agents or other customers in the field will use the technology and what additional improvements should be made is a key step in successfully deploying the technology. Without understanding the human elements in this process, I'm concerned we could be investing significant federal resources in potentially unusable technology. I look forward to hearing from Dr. Ironman about the importance of social science in the evaluation and deployment of new technologies at DHS. Securing our borders is a difficult and complex problem. People and materials can enter by air, land, and sea. This requires our border security efforts to not only effectively communicate internally, but also coordinate with other federal agencies, as well as state and local governments. I hope our discussion today provides the committee with recommendations to inform our oversight and legislative responsibilities for R&D at the Department of Homeland Security. And I look forward to hearing about how public and private sector innovation can help protect the American border. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back to balance my time.
Thank you, Mr. Lipinski. The chair now recognizes the chairman of the Subcommittee on Oversight, the gentleman from Georgia, Dr. Brown, for his opening statement.
Thank you, Dr. Bashan. And I welcome all of y'all here today as witnesses, and I'm looking forward in this to hearing from all y'all about this very important issue. Earlier this month, I traveled to the southern border of our country with the Homeland Security Committee. We held a field hearing in McAllen, Texas on July the 3rd, where we discussed the recent surge of unaccompanied minors, UACs, crossing the border. I was astounded to learn that the number of children illegally entering the United States from Central America has grown from approximately 5,000 of them a year to an estimated 57,000 so far this year, and they're projecting up to 90,000 in this fiscal year. An influx of this extent raises questions about the security of our southern border. Currently, Border Patrol agents are inundated with processing unaccompanied minors and not fulfilling their primary mission to safeguard the border against terrorists entering the country under the radar, as well as drugs and other things that are entering. It's a national security issue, as far as I'm concerned. In order to protect the nearly 2,000-mile southwest border, patrol agents would benefit from advances in modern technology, such as video monitors, sensors, radars, cameras, thermal imaging devices, and drones. However, there are many flaws within the various DHS components that conduct technology research and development, which include problems in the management, coordination, and acquisition of items needed to help secure our American border. In 2012, GAO report notes that, quote, the Department of Homeland Security does not know the total amount its components invest in research and development and does not have policies and guidance for defining R&D and overseeing R&D resources across the department, unquote. Further, the 2013 GAO report cites examples where projects were delayed and canceled due to an inability to obtain data from DHS. This is intolerable. The DHS Science and Technology Directorate states on its own website that it is, quote, the primary research and development arm of the Department of Homeland Security and manages science and technology research from development through transition for the department's operational components and first responders to protect the homeland, unquote. How can this primary research and development arm not have any idea of the total amount of taxpayer money being invested on technology to detect, prevent, and mitigate threats to our nation? This is not the prescription to protect our homeland. As the chairman of this committee's oversight subcommittee, I value transparency and accountability. The S&T Directorate needs to lay out a clear and comprehensive plan to manage research and development activities and coordinate with other entities to ensure the deployment of effective, state-of-the-art technology in a timely fashion. Absent a strategic technology roadmap, our citizens will remain vulnerable to threats stemming from our unsecure border. Thank you, Dr. Bashan. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for holding this very important hearing. Now I yield back the balance of my time.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Brown. The chair now recognizes the ranking member of the Subcommittee on Oversight, Mr. Maffei of New York, for his opening statement.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Chairman Bashan, for holding this hearing. I want to thank Chairman Brown as well and Ranking Member Lipinski. Our current system and approach to immigration is clearly not working. The challenges are complex and must be dealt with in a bipartisan way. The only way to fully address these challenges and make sure the crisis of unaccompanied children coming over the border is taken care of is to enact bipartisan, comprehensive immigration reform. That's why I've co-sponsored the bipartisan legislation that would bolster security at our borders and uphold the immigration laws already on the books. The Senate has already passed this bipartisan immigration reform bill by a wide margin, and I do believe it is time for the House to act as well, at least to bring it up for a vote. What is essential is that we strengthen our borders and enforce our laws. That is essential to any nation's sovereignty, to control its own borders. But I want to say I agree with Mr. Brown, my friend Mr. Brown from Georgia, that border security must be focused on keeping terrorists and weapons of mass destruction, as well as illegal firearms and dangerous drugs, from entering the United States. Again, the need for reform. For the purposes of this hearing, I look forward to hearing the witnesses' testimony on the research, development, and implementation of new technologies on America's border and potential new technologies that might be more effective. It's unfortunate that the committee was unable to obtain witnesses from the Department of Homeland Security, Science and Technology Directorate, or host a joint hearing with the House Homeland Security Committee, as there is a lot of overlap in this area, and that would have been more helpful. That said, I am very grateful to the chairs for calling this hearing. It is extremely important. It is important in my district, which does have a border. It's a border with Canada. But I do want to also know what is going on in the northern border. And I know Dr. Maurer would probably share that interest, since his family is from Wayne County, which is in my district and does have that water border with Canada. Being able to accurately monitor the integrity of U.S. borders is essential to maintaining border and national security, which is essential to our sovereignty. I look forward to our witnesses helping us to better understand the science behind these issues and evaluate how technology can augment and support the human resources that are ultimately responsible for maintaining our border security. I yield back.
Thank you. I now recognize the chairman of the full committee, the gentleman from Texas.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We are all aware of the impact of illegal immigrant children who stream across our southern border. This is both a national security and a humanitarian crisis that we cannot allow to continue. A country that has lost control of its borders has lost control of its future. The President has ignored, failed to enforce, undermined, and unilaterally changed current immigration laws. As a result, millions of young people have risked their lives to make the dangerous trip and come here illegally. Further, the administration has yet to present a plan to secure our nation's borders. As border agents are forced to turn increased attention to the surge of minors concentrated in certain areas along the border, it leaves much of the rest of the border unprotected. Technology is a key component to securing our 2,000-mile southern border. Customs and Border Protection and National Guard troops cannot be everywhere. Sensors deployed along the border can detect and track the coyotes who smuggle children, as well as illegal drugs and firearms, across the border. Sensors will help Border Patrol agents know where coyotes are so they can intercept and stop them. And ground-penetrating radar can find buried tunnels that crisscross our border. We need to get this technology in the hands of our immigration officers. Unfortunately, the Department of Homeland Security has a poor track record when it comes to developing and fielding sensors and tactical communications infrastructure along the southwest border. The Government Accountability Office, GAO, finds the Department of Homeland Security's research and development efforts to be, quote, fragmented and overlapping, end quote. The Department of Science and Technology Directorate will spend $1.2 billion this year on numerous projects, some related to border security, but many are not. As in previous years, the GAO found hundreds of millions of dollars being spent each year on duplicative R&D projects and by other offices within the department. Frankly, no one knows who's in charge of research and development or what the goal is. The GAO reports that the Science and Technology Directorate lost touch with its end users about what technologies and R&D projects should be a priority. Today's witnesses will testify on the need for the Department of Homeland Security to develop a plan to secure America's borders and how best to carry out that plan. Research and technology are key components to securing America's borders. In September, we will hear from the Department of Homeland Security Undersecretary for Science and Technology, a position created by this committee in founding the department, in a joint hearing with the Homeland Security Committee. We are working with them on draft legislation to set priorities for the Science and Technology Directorate on how to secure America's borders. I look forward to working with my colleagues in the weeks ahead to turn this goal into a reality. While there may be mixed feelings about the current situation on our southern border, we should all be able to agree that we can and we must secure America's borders with the help of technology. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Thank you, Chairman. If there are members who wish to submit additional opening statements, your statements will be added to the record at this point. At this point, I would like to introduce our witnesses. Our first witness, Dr. Jack Riley, is Vice President of RAND's National Security Research Division and Director of the National Defense Research Institute. Dr. Riley received his bachelor's from the University of Michigan, his master's from Georgetown, and his PhD from the RAND Graduate School. Our second witness is Mr. David Maurer. He is the Director of the U.S. Government Accountability Office's Homeland Security and Justice Team. Mr. Maurer earned his bachelor's from Michigan State, competition right next door, and his two master's degrees from the University of Michigan, and the National Defense University. Our third witness is Dr. Joseph Eierman. Dr. Eierman is co-director of the Institute for Homeland Security Solutions, a senior research methodologist and the director of RTI International Center for Security, Safety, and Defense. Dr. Eierman received his bachelor's from Muskegon University, his two master's degrees from Florida State University and Miami University, and his PhD from Florida State University. Welcome to all our witnesses. As our witnesses should know, spoken testimony is limited to 5 minutes each, after which the members of the committee will have 5 minutes each to ask questions. It is the practice of the Subcommittee on Oversight to receive testimony under oath. Does anyone have a problem with that? If not, then now please stand and raise your right hand. Do you solemnly swear to affirm to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
Let the record reflect that all the witnesses, and you may be seated. Let the record reflect that all the witnesses participating have taken the oath. At this point, I recognize Dr. Riley for 5 minutes to present his testimony.
Thank you, Chairman Bouchon and Brown and Ranking Members Lipinski and Maffei for the opportunity to testify today about strategic planning and technology needs for air, land, and sea border security. Almost exactly 8 years ago, I testified before two Homeland Security subcommittees on this same topic. And at that time, I said, and I quote, "We have woefully underinvested in developing, evaluating, and refining a comprehensive and integrated border security strategy. We have invested in numerous border security programs and initiatives, but the impacts and the costs and the cost effectiveness of virtually all of these initiatives are poorly understood," end quote. Unfortunately, nearly a decade later, the same concerns still largely apply. So let me turn to 3 points that I will make in this testimony. First, we need to invest in measurement and data so that we have an empirical basis from which to have policy debates. Second, we need to invest in more systematically understanding the cost effectiveness of programs and policies. And third and finally, we need to systematically track and document how border control efforts affect the larger economy and society. Let me start my first point by explaining why the data gaps are so worrisome. Effective border security begins with understanding why and how people and contraband cross the border. Different motivations may require different policies. Migration, for example, motivated by the desire for economic betterment, may be best controlled by a combination of border deterrence and labor market enforcement. In contrast, smuggling of contraband may be best addressed by deterrence and technological detection. In my written testimony, I detail some of the ways in which we can capture this kind of data. However, as far as I can tell, none of these estimation methods have been formally adopted, nor do they receive continued support for development and refinement. They should, however, so that they can become the foundation for a border security scorecard. I'll turn now to my second point, why it's important to know about cost effectiveness. Imagine that Secretary Johnson is presented with the opportunity to add 10,000 Border Patrol agents. Using the kind of data I just mentioned, he could not only assess the effectiveness of additional agents, but give guidance on where and how to deploy them. We could also give guidance on what technologies might be good substitutes for or complements to the additional personnel. But equally importantly, we could say something about how migrants and smugglers would adapt to the presence of additional personnel. Indeed, with better data, we might be able to predict how behavior might adapt and correspondingly modify our policies. At a minimum, we would likely detect the changes in behavior earlier, which in turn would help with improving future policymaking. Third, a word about the broader economic and social implications of the border. Policies designed to improve control over the border can propagate widely throughout the economy and society. To give one example, after 9/11, we changed visa policies to make it more difficult for terrorists to travel to the United States. However, by making it more difficult, we deter not only terrorists, but also an unknown number of legitimate travelers, foreign tourists, foreign students, qualified foreign workers, whose presence provide great benefits to our economy and the vibrancy of our culture. In short, border enforcement directly and indirectly touches on every aspect of the economy and our livelihoods, and we should be systematically tracking these effects so that we understand the full costs and the full benefits of border security programs. At the beginning of this oral statement, I mentioned I have three points. However, I want to add a fourth. Border security is one of the greatest analytic challenges of the post 9/11 generation. It is a topic that can and should attract the best and the brightest minds. But it remains frustratingly difficult to work on the topic, both because of departmental restrictions on access to the data that are collected, and also because of departmental restrictions on publishing and academic engagement. Good science demands public scrutiny and rigorous academic engagement. I urge this committee and the subcommittees to exercise its oversight role and help make this topic better grounded in science and more attractive to the best analysts and researchers. Thank you for the opportunity to testify today, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you very much. I now recognize Mr. Maurer for 5 minutes for his testimony.
Good morning, Chairman Bashan, Chairman Brown, Chairman Smith, Ranking Member Lipinski, Ranking Member Maffei, and members and staff. I'm pleased to be here this morning to talk about the results of our recently issued work looking at research and development at the Department of Homeland Security and how those efforts are being used to enhance border security. R&D matters at DHS for a couple of reasons. First, the taxpayers provide DHS over $1 billion a year to support research and development. For that reason alone, the department needs to ensure its R&D activities work as planned. R&D can also help DHS better execute its various missions. For example, improved technology to detect people or nuclear material helps DHS secure the border and ultimately the homeland. Now, DHS has made important strides in recent years toward taking a more strategic approach. For example, the Science and Technology Directorate has a strategic plan, periodically reviews its portfolio of projects, and has developed new ways to coordinate with other DHS components. That last point is especially important since S&T strives to conduct its R&D work side by side with the eventual end users. But that said, DHS clearly has a lot of work ahead to bring coherence and structure to its research and development efforts. Our work over the past 2 years identified three key areas where DHS needs to improve. We found that DHS needed to define R&D, do a better job tracking R&D, and improve how it coordinates R&D. I'll briefly expand on these 3 points. In September 2012, we reported that DHS lacked a common definition of research and development, and we found a lot of activity across the department that could be considered R&D, and by law, S&T is responsible for coordinating and overseeing all of it. But they can't do that if the various DHS components aren't working from the same definition and agree on what should be coordinated. Our work also found several problems in DHS's efforts to centrally track R&D. As it turned out, DHS struggled to answer basic questions such as, how much are you spending? Which components are doing R&D? What projects are currently underway? And do completed projects meet the needs of their customers? For example, we found that DHS did not know how much its components invested in R&D, and that makes it really difficult to oversee activities across the entire department. This inability to centrally track R&D also places DHS at risk of overlapping and duplicative efforts. We identified 35 instances where contracted R&D activity in one component overlapped with another. Our work also identified problems in DHS's ability to coordinate R&D. There are several R&D coordination mechanisms within DHS, but they need to work better. For example, the report we issued last year on border and maritime found a mixed picture. The good news is that the Domestic Nuclear Detection Office and the Coast Guard regularly reach out to end users of their completed R&D projects. However, S&T lacked any formal approach to follow up with the end users of its deliverables. S&T's customers were also much more likely to report that S&T deliverables did not meet end user needs. And in some instances, we were unable to locate an end user for an S&T project. For example, S&T spent more than $1 million on a project to enhance CBP's ability to track maritime vessels without having a specific customer at CBP. Our recent work also found problems in DHS's coordination of R&D work with the national labs. So what is DHS doing to better define, track, and coordinate R&D? On the plus side, the department now has a common definition for R&D, and that's an important first step. However, while DHS has taken some actions, they are still not sufficient to address our recommendations to improve how they track and coordinate R&D. And that's important because clearly defined, closely tracked, and well-coordinated R&D activities will help translate state-of-the-art science into usable tools that can help enhance the security of our borders. We will keep the committee informed on the department's ongoing efforts to address our recommendations. Mr. Chairman, thank you. That concludes my opening remarks. I look forward to your questions.
Thank you very much. I now recognize Dr. Ironman for 5 minutes for his testimony.
Good morning, Chairman Bouchon, Chairman Brown, Chairman Smith, Ranking Member Lipinski, and Ranking Member Maffei, and distinguished members of the committee. I thank you for the opportunity to testify today regarding technology needed to secure America's borders. I have prepared a written testimony and requested it be entered into the record. I have been working closely with DHS Science and Technology Directorate on a series of program and technology evaluations for the past 6 years in my role as Director of the Institute for Homeland Security Solutions at RTI International. Our work with DHS is part of a larger RTI project to better understand the human factors that contribute to the transition of new technologies into the public sector and the private market. I'm a social scientist by training, and in my role with IHSS, I've had the opportunity to apply social science research methods to the evaluation of DHS programs and the application of new technologies. In my expert opinion, social science can help us understand the general public, that is, the customers, and the DHS staff who will use the new technologies. This is just as important when developing technologies for securing our borders as it is for the next big project from Apple or Google. Failure to understand the customer can cause us to develop new technologies that are never adopted or never used to their full potential. This increases cost and delays the transition to application. In our work with DHS, we use social science methods to support technology development by S&T programs to better understand the end users and customers in things like staffing and training requirements, usability of the new technology, and public perceptions about privacy and safety. As part of our work, we have been fortunate enough to employ these methods in support of several DHS technologies, including a DHS S&T-funded assessment of the rapid DNA pilot test, part of a study to develop technology for field DNA tests to support applications by refugees for entrance into the U.S., a DHS S&T-funded examination of non-technical barriers encountered by program managers designed to identify trends and patterns that can guide the program managers in the transition of future technologies. And finally, an assessment of non-technical factors that will contribute to the safe and successful transition of unmanned aircraft into the routine aspects of our economic and social lives. Some of the key findings of these studies that are relevant to the transition of DHS technology to border security are, first, strong and potentially beneficial technologies can be derailed by non-technical problems stemming from a failure to understand the needs and abilities of the workforce, the complexities of public perceptions, and the willingness of the public to accept certain types of technologies into their daily lives. Second, the social science evaluation model is rarely applied to new technologies by DHS, and when it is applied, it's used in a limited, non-standard manner. This may delay the transition of technologies and may limit our ability to assess the impact and effectiveness of those technologies on the agency missions. Finally, complex technologies can develop at a slower rate than the operational realities of the components. This often results in technologies that are developed without a clear operational partner for implementation because needs have changed and priorities have shifted. My written testimony includes more detail on these and other technology assessments. We continue to examine these challenges and make recommendations for changes that will expedite the transition process to bring new technologies to bear on our security needs in a more efficient and timely manner. Thank you for your interest, and thank you for any questions you may have.
Thank you very much. I want to thank the witnesses for their testimony, and at this point remind members that the committee rules limit questioning to 5 minutes. The chair at this point will open the round of questions. I recognize myself for 5 minutes. Dr. Riley, what is the feasibility of adopting existing surveillance systems such as those used in Iraq and Afghanistan on the southern border?
Additional information.
For example, you know, DOD has surveillance equipment that we currently use in Iraq and Afghanistan, mobile equipment and others that have some potential that we may not need to do duplicative scientific and technical research on that
right.
would make them applicable with the dual use purpose of being used on the southern border, similar concept.
I'd be in favor of a structured test to understand how they would work at the U.S. border and in which ways they can be effective. But at this point, I'm not convinced that we need significant investment in new technologies more than we need careful assessment of what we already have in place and how well the pieces work together.
Understood. Mr. Maurer, from your past work with S&T, what are the most important lessons learned that you would share with the new S&T leadership?
Well, I think first and foremost, I would highlight the two remaining outstanding areas they have to show some more progress on, which is namely do a better job tracking, a better job coordinating the R&D efforts, not just within the Science and Technology Directorate, but across the entire department. S&T has that statutory responsibility, and frankly, they've struggled with having close coordination with some of the other operational components that are doing R&D activities. I'd encourage him to take action on that front and ensure that the other thing I would have them do is ensure that they are more tightly in tune with the needs of the eventual end users of the technologies that they're developing. They are making strides toward that. His predecessor spent a lot of time and effort trying to get S&T more tightly bound with not just R&D, but getting involved in acquisition as well. I think that's a good step.
Yeah, I would agree with that, that it may very well be important to coordinate with a potential end user, although sometimes the end users don't really know what they might need until the inventors or people invent something. that might be useful. I think Apple did that. That was kind of why they did no product research, because they felt like people didn't really know what they would use until you develop it. But so there's two arguments there, but I do think better coordination is very important. Through its authorizing statute, DHS, S&T is responsible for developing a national policy and strategic plan for the federal government's civilian efforts to identify and develop countermeasures for emerging terrorist threats. S&T is also tasked with coordinating the development and management of science and technology agenda for DHS. To the best of my knowledge, DHS, S&T has not yet accomplished either of these responsibilities. Dr. Riley and Mr. Maurer, both of you testified about the lack of coordination for border technology R&D within DHS. As we look toward reauthorizing the S&T Directorate, should these strategic planning and coordination responsibilities remain within DHS S&T? If so, how can we prompt movement on these important tasks? If not, where might they better be situated and why? Mr. Maurer.
Yeah, I think it's important that under the current statutory framework for S&T and the department to do what the law required them to do, which is establish a strategy for within the department and work with their partners across government. The broader policy issue of whether they should continue to have that responsibility, I know there's reauthorization language, is really a policy consideration. One thing that's important to keep in mind is that the amount of money that DHS spends on R&D is about 1/6 of the total that's spent across the entire federal government on Homeland Security-related R&D. So somebody somewhere is going to have to be involved in trying to bring coherence and coordination and oversight on those funds.
Dr. Riley?
I'll just add that one of the things that may or may not help, I'm not sure I've made up my mind on this, is better use of Undersecretary of Policy in the Department of Homeland Security. Right now that's an assistant secretary position, and one of the ways in which stitches may be dropped between the generation of technology and implementation and effective use of them is perhaps in not having a counterpart on policy formulation and execution.
Thank you. I recognize Mr. Lipinski for his line of questioning.
Thank you. Dr. Ironman, you've been working directly with DHS, S&T for the past 6 years in evaluating their programs. In the latter part of your testimony, you listed a variety of barriers to successful transition of new technologies from the laboratory to the operational setting in the DHS components. Could you elaborate on what DHS can do to further the transfer technology to users? And do you have any idea what has held DHS back in developing a strategy to address these challenges?
Thank you for your question, Mr. Lipinski. I would say there are two issues that have affected the ability to increase the involvement of social science research in DHS technology transition. One is the absence of a standardized process for inserting social science research that involves the end users and the customers and the DHS staff in the study design, the project implementation, and the assessment of the results. And I think that's primarily due to a lack of coordination within S&T around the social sciences. At one point, there was a division in S&T focused on the human factors. That division has been removed and merged in with another division, and staff have been eliminated.
Was there any particular reason that that was removed that you know of?
I don't know the reason behind that. That's beyond my knowledge. I do know that many of the staff were retained, but the second barrier, I think, to the adoption is the number of staff that are focused on social science research methods at DHS. I think the first issue could be addressed with better coordination and planning and a standardized process for inserting evaluation of the customers and the workers in the R&D cycle. The second one is more of a staffing and budget issue.
All right, thank you. Dr. Riley, you mentioned in your testimony that after many years we're still lacking the analytic capability to measure the effectiveness of our border security tools and policy mechanisms. I understand your solution for measuring this is further investment in developing a strategy for R&D and investment in technology infrastructure. Considering there are various types of illegal border activity with no one-size-fits-all solution, what types of technology should we invest in to get the necessary data and models?
Well, in terms of technology development and investment in that area, I think one of the things I'd be looking for is a tighter and better designed requirements generation process so that we understand where the frontline providers of border security feel the need for new technologies and perceive the need for additional technology development. There's been some progress made in that area, but generally, for example, the connection between technology transfer and requirements development in DHS is not as mature as it is, say, in the Department of Defense.
And what's the reason for that? Just has not been developed?
I think growing pains. And there are significant structural differences between the Department of Defense and the Department of Homeland Security. But I think the mere process of trying to incorporate all of the different elements that went into DHS and get them functioning smoothly is probably a limiting factor.
Okay. And Dr. Maurer, Mr. Maurer, according to multiple GAO reports, the DHS is missing a strategic plan, which we had talked about. Further, it can't track its investments in R&D and thus cannot identify the total investment it has made in R&D. GAO has made recommendations to solve these problems, but DHS has been quite vague, saying it has taken some steps to update guidance. Now, since your office has been monitoring their progress, do you have an idea as to what has been getting in the way of developing this plan?
That's a really good question, because we've been recommending this. Some of this goes back to a report that was issued 2 years ago. So DHS would be better placed to give the specific reasons. Our sense is that they've certainly made progress on defining R&D, so that's the first step. But we would like to see them develop a strategy for the whole department. We'd like to see them develop a way to clearly articulate what processes and coordination mechanisms need to be in place, have a more effective way of implementing the various R&D projects across the department. I would hope that the relatively new undersecretary would take this on as one of his top priorities in his new role.
Very good. Thank you. I'll yield back.
Thank you. I now recognize Chairman Brown for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to follow up on that question. In my opening statement, I mentioned that DHS needs a technology roadmap to manage its R&D activities. What is DHS's biggest impediment to developing that organized and comprehensive national border security strategy? Let's start with Mr. Maurer.
I would say that probably the biggest challenge they face is just the sheer complexity of the task that they're trying to accomplish. It involves predominantly at CBP, but it's going to involve science and technology and other parts of the department as well. It's a multifaceted problem which touches on many different aspects of the department, so it's a difficult challenge that they face. And trying to come up with a comprehensive strategy is also difficult. Now, we've been somewhat critical of the department on different aspects of border security and their ability to measure the impact of the technology investments, for example, that they've made over the past many years. If they can make progress on that front, that would help get them further down the road where they need to be on developing a comprehensive strategy for border security.
Well, if you can give us in part of the what we call QFR's questions for the record, recommendations of how to get over this impediment. Dr. Riley, do you have any comments or on this also?
Just jotting a note to myself, the board is obviously a complex issue. Different pieces of the bureaucracy, even within the Department of Homeland Security, touch on the border, and nobody really owns it. We need to find a way to get a greater single point of accountability on the breadth of border issues, whether that's something that is, as I said in previous comment, integrated in an undersecretary for policy, whether it's the appointment of a border czar, as we've done on other policy issues in other contexts, I'm not quite sure. But there is no single point of accountability on the border, and having that may be something that prompts progress.
Mr. Maurer, let me read to you a few sentences from your own testimony related to DHS R&D activities. You said, S&T officials told us at the time that a process did not exist at DHS or within S&T to prevent overlap or unnecessary duplication. We also found in September 2012 that neither DHS nor S&T tracked all ongoing R&D projects across the department, including R&D activities contracted through the national laboratories. As part of our review, we identified 11 components that reimbursed the national laboratories for R&D from fiscal years 2010 through 2012, but S&T's Office of National Laboratories could not provide us with any information on those activities and told us it did not track them. As of July 2014, DHS has not developed new policy guidance. These are issues going back for a couple of years. Now, I understand that in some areas, DHS appears to be taking initial steps to meet GAO's multiple recommendations, such as conducting portfolio reviews across the department and collecting feedback from customers. But this department is no longer in its infancy. In fact, it's been around for over a decade now. And when I read that the DHS has not yet determined the most effective path to guide R&D across the department, or that S&T has not developed new policy guidance, I have to ask, should some or all of DHS's R&D components be placed on GAO's high-risk list, which, you, as you know, is reserved for agencies and program areas vulnerable to fraud, waste, abuse, and mismanagement? Or are they in most need of transformation? So should they be on the high-risk list?
Well, to some extent, they already are. We have an existing high-risk area for improving.
But have you named them on the high-risk list?
Specifically to R&D?
Yes.
We don't have a specific shout-out to R&D, but the problems that they face in terms of coordination and tracking are rooted in more fundamental issues with the department's inability to stitch itself together in a comprehensive way. So we have a high-risk area for management at DHS, which has been critical of DHS's efforts to develop a common approach to acquisition and financial management, information technology, human capital. A lot of these things are the building blocks of organizations, and to some extent are some of the root causes as to why DHS doesn't have visibility over R&D spending. They don't have the financial systems that allow them to do that, for example.
Well, my time's about up. I encourage you to put them on the high-risk list, because just by your own testimony, there's just tremendous problems there, and I think it should be, and I encourage you to do so. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Thank you. Votes have been called, but we do have some time, so we're going to go ahead, and I'm going to go ahead and recognize Mr. Maffei for his line of questioning, and then we'll see where we are and then go from there.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Maurer, first of all, I apologize for giving you a doctorate in my opening time. You can pick that up after the hearing. I really appreciate the work of all the witnesses on this, and it's been a very informative hearing. One thing I want to ask you, Mr. Maurer, is DHS has had some rather large R&D failures. One example is that they canceled a very large and one of the most comprehensive technological investments, SBINet, after investing nearly $1 billion. Has this changed at all the way they're approaching it, and how are they able to salvage any of that technology?
Yeah, you're absolutely right. SBINet was a failed project at DHS. DHS has a slightly different approach to developing new technology for the border. They have the Arizona Technology Plan. DHS's current approach is to rely more extensively on commercial off-the-shelf technology and using that to deploy for security, for helping secure the border. We still have some concerns about how that particular program is being implemented, specifically in the area of testing. We've issued reports and we've testified previously that we don't believe that the amount of testing that's going to be done for the Arizona Technology Plan is sufficient. That was one of the root causes of the problems that plagued SBINet. So our hope is that DHS will take us up and adopt our recommendation.
Thank you. Dr. Riley, can you give me any sense, how robust is this technology? I mean, I think, I don't want to be cynical, but sometimes you get the impression that I've got a bunch of friends from high school who are really good technically, and, you know, they could come up, set up motion sensors, cameras, lasers, even UAVs now, and for a much cheaper cost do a lot of the same thing. Tell me I'm wrong.
The technologies are good and mature. I think one of the areas where DHS and, frankly, many government agencies struggles is kind of the tooth to tail. Where do you have the people to back up and integrate with the technology to make the most and best effective use of it. DHS is making progress in this area. Their acquisition processes are maturing, but they're certainly not perfect at this point.
Thanks. Dr. Ironman, do you have anything to add, particularly involving that human, the human element there?
Absolutely. I completely agree with Mr. or Dr. Riley's comments. We worked on an evaluation of a technology for biometric identification at the airport. The technology was quite ready. It was off the shelf. It was effective. The problem was is the technology couldn't be integrated into the human systems. And that's where it would break down, because if it was integrated into the human systems, it would result in large delays at the airport. It was unclear who would be responsible for implementing the technology, and there were serious cost implications for the airlines, which couldn't be addressed by the technology, only by research into the humans.
Thank you very much. I'm going to yield my final 2 minutes to the gentlewoman from Connecticut, Ms. Estee.
Thank you. Quick question, follow-up for you, Mr. Maurer. You had mentioned that only a sixth of the R&D funding around border issues is actually done with DHS. We've already heard considerable testimony how that isn't even managed very well. So where's the other five-sixths? Who are the lead agencies? And how should we be thinking about who sets the strategic goals? How can they be better coordinated? We really like your advice, and then if others want to chime in. Thank you.
Sure, absolutely. DHS is one-sixth of the total pie for all of Homeland Security R&D, so we don't know how it breaks out specifically for border, but the other five-sixths for all Homeland Security, a lot of it's being done at DOD and the Health Department of Health and Human Services. Writ large, one thing that would help that overall coordination is the development of the statutorily required government-wide approach to Homeland Security R&D, and that's something that's been on the books for a number of years.
Thank you. Anybody else?
I'll just say that I think in conversations and discussion about the border, it's common to lapse into thinking only about the southern land border, and we really need to be more careful thinking holistically about air, sea, and land borders, north and south.
Coming from Connecticut, we think about this in terms of our ports. I mean, it is an issue. We have the Strategic Petroleum Reserve. In my state, we have nuclear plants all up and down the East Coast that are right on the coast, and I heartily agree we can't just be thinking about the southern border. Thank you.
I now yield to the Chairman of the full committee, Mr. Smith.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First of all, I'd like to enter into the record two items from Petro Data Communications.
No objection, so ordered.
Thank you. And let me say to our witnesses, we're going to try to squeeze in two more questioners and in the next 7 or 8 minutes, so if you could give brief responses to my questions, we'll see if that works. Dr. Riley, let me address my first question to you, and that is, in 2011, the administration canceled the Secure Border Initiative. In 2012, it withdrew 1,200 National Guard troops from the border. Do you think the result of those actions made it easier for illegal immigrants to cross the border?
Difficult to say, Mr. Chairman, but both of those were important initiatives that I frankly would like to see followed through on in the near future.
Okay. Thank you. And the next question is to all three of you all, if you would, and that is, how would you grade the Department of Homeland Security on its use of technology today to secure the border? Real quickly, Dr. Riley?
Incomplete.
Dr. Maurer?
I would say the same thing, incomplete.
Okay. Dr. Everman?
I agree.
Okay. What type of technology are they using, Dr. Riley or Dr. Maurer?
There's a large range of technologies from unmanned aerostats and...
You're saying just a lot more they could be doing. Is that what you meant by incomplete?
It's simply too complicated an issue to grade out in a few minutes before a committee like this, I think.
Okay, well, we'll take the incomplete for the time being. Mr. Moore, I want to ask you a question about the GAO. In 2011, you took a look at, I think, 873 miles of border. You said only 15% was under control of the border patrol. What did you mean by under control? How would you define that?
In that report, we were using a measure that CBP used at that time for operational control of the border. CBP has no longer uses that particular measure in their effort to assess border security.
Yeah, but my question was, what did the definition mean then when you undertook the study of control of the border, only 15%?
I think that was part of the problem, and that's part of the reason why CBP moved away from that definition. It was open to wide interpretation.
I think the reason they moved away because it was embarrassing that only 15% of the border was under full control, myself. But again, full control, I was told in a previous hearing, meant that there was a high likelihood that illegal immigrants would be intercepted.
That's correct. That tracks back to the work that we did in 2011. Okay.
Which left 85% of the border under something less than full control. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm going to yield now the remainder of my time to the gentleman from Arizona, Mr. Schweikert.
I ask a unanimous consent to allow Mr. Schweikert to participate in the hearing. Without objection, the chair, then his order is so ordered.
You mean I could have objected to myself being here? Okay, now let's see if we can do a quick lightning round here. Dr. Riley, in your written testimony, I think actually in your spoken testimony, there was a comment about some of the access to data and how much data was sort of off books or you were not allowed to gain access to. Can you give me a quick snippet of how that affects trying to create policy and design?
It limits the ability to interact in the academic and analytic communities, and it has a stifling effect on being able to develop innovative approaches to border security.
So if Dr. Ironman is trying to look at data sets to build a human interaction, he doesn't actually have enough robust data sets to work from.
It's not only the availability of the data, although that's certainly the case. Those data need to be collected and the data sets built, but it's also the ability to draw in our academic partners. IHSS is a consortium with Duke and UNC, and many of the universities won't work on data that's not publishable.
Well, and formerly, Dr. Mr. Maurer, you actually almost just touched on this, that for many of us who are trying to get our heads around border policy and being from a border state, the definitions keep changing on me. One day we calculate it this way, the next day we calculate it this way. One day, for human smuggling, if you're captured in this distance, you're considered deportation. The next day that's redefined. When you're doing your analysis, is this a continued problem of the constantly moving the definitions, let alone the access to the actual data for the researchers?
That certainly makes it more difficult to have a consistent. They don't have consistent measures for assessing border security, and they've changed from year to year, going back to 2011. So that does make that more challenging. And we've had reports that have talked about the important need for that. Most critically, having need to assess the impact of the technologies that have been deployed on the border. And we've been critical of CBP's inability to demonstrate the extent to which deployed technology, what impact that has on security.
Ms. Chairman, I know I'm over time, but from my understanding, this is actually a bigger issue than a lot of people understand, is it's hard to know what you're chasing when two things happen. They don't tell you, or they change that definition. And then there's the whole more cultural decision of, can you ever have a large bureaucracy be as nimble and flexible when trying to design fixed technologies when the other side is incentivized to constantly beat that technology and be more nimble for the profit side. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. At this point, I'd like to thank the witnesses for their valuable testimony. We will not be returning after votes. We'll be adjourning here shortly, as everyone has been able to ask their questions. Your written testimony and your oral testimony is very valuable to the subcommittee. Members of the committee may have additional questions for you, and we ask that you respond to those in writing. The record will remain open for 2 weeks for additional comments and written questions from members. At this point, the witnesses are excused, and the hearing is adjourned.